Learn from top professors on the road or in your home with Learn 25.
Jamie Pope is a leading expert on nutrition and an assistant professor at Vanderbilt University. The textbook she co-authored, Nutrition for a Changing World, is used by more than 140 universities across the United States. Beyond the classroom, she adapted portions of her nutrition courses into a massive open online course, attracting more than 175,000 participants from around the world and earning her an Innovation in Teaching Award. Professor Pope is a fellow of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics and the co-author of several popular press books, including The T-Factor Fat Gram Counter, which remained on the New York Times bestseller list for more than 3 years. She has authored or contributed to numerous scientific and popular press publications. Professor Pope has also served in several corporate positions as a nutrition consultant and media representative.
Topic 1, Navigating Nutrition, Introduction. Welcome to Nutrition 101. I'm Jamie Pope, a registered dietitian nutritionist and longtime nutrition professor at Vanderbilt University in Nashville, Tennessee. I'm also co-author of the introductory nutrition textbook, Nutrition for a Changing World, with my colleague and friend, nutrition biochemist, Dr. Stephen Nazilski. The education, experiences, and opportunities over the years have combined to keep me abreast of developments in my field, but also keep me humble in regards to how much there is to know and keep up with across the very diverse and evolving field of nutrition. Over my 40-plus years in the field of nutrition, I've seen advances in knowledge and a growing appreciation of the role of diet in our health, in disease prevention, and in aging well. I've also seen numerous trends, approaches, and recommendations, many of which come and go. Others have made the test of time and evidence. Being a nutrition professional isn't always easy. Few areas in the health sciences are so fraught with debate, discourse, and confusion. Confusion for the public and for health professionals alike. In the public arena, nutrition seems to be as much a belief system as a science. I've found that people often have very entrenched opinions about food and dietary approaches that might be based in sound nutrition science and research, but may also stem from something they read or heard in the media, found online, or were told by a friend or family member. Studies show that while most people trust health professionals as a source of credible information and advice, most of their information comes from internet searches, news stories, friends, and even social media. In my introductory nutrition course at Vanderbilt, a primary goal for my students, and now for you, is to leave the course as better consumers, able to better evaluate what you read, what you hear in the media, or see on products in the marketplace, against what's sound and current scientific evidence. I want them, my students, and you, to question the many nutrition-related claims that you read or hear about and consider more than just a headline or a claim on a food or supplement label. I hope my students, whether in the classroom or as part of this course, have a better grasp of foundational nutrition concepts and terms. Terms they've likely heard, but might not understand the implications of or context within a healthy diet. For example, before trans fats were banned, and we'll talk about those later in the course, I would show my students two cracker boxes that both contained so-called butter crackers, except one said no trans fats on the front of the box. When asked which they would buy if they were priced the same, students almost unanimously said the one declaring no trans fats. I then asked a room of over 180 students if someone could tell me what trans fats were and the benefit of a no trans fat product. Only one student was brave enough to raise their hand and say, "I just know they're bad for you." Yes, in fact, just 1% of total calories from trans fat increases the risk of heart disease through its impact on blood cholesterol. But as we'll learn, trans fats are created when an oil is made more solid by a chemical process called partial hydrogenation, changing the configuration of the fatty acid. And much to my students' surprise, butter has no trans fat, but more on that and other topics later. I assume that since you decided to listen to a course on nutrition, that you have an interest in nutrition, food, and health. It is indeed an interesting area of study and application, but it's challenging as well. Nutrition is a young and evolving science with new research coming out constantly that might validate previous theories or give pause for another perspective. No wonder the public gets confused and frustrated with mixed messages and sometimes even reversal of previous recommendations. I hope this course will help provide a foundation to better understand terms and concepts and provide tools and strategies to help you sift through the changing information that bombards us each day when we turn on our computers or the TV or even gather with friends. I'm not going to give you my personal opinions in this course. Rather, I will hopefully translate and share current evidence and knowledge in nutrition science. I do have my own perspectives and beliefs about nutrition and health, but these are grounded in what scientific literature, nutrition scientists, and credible health organizations publish for professionals and the public. For many questions in nutrition, and new questions arise constantly, they're not always concrete answers. For most, the best and only answer is to say, based on current evidence, or what we know to date, or even evidence is inconclusive and more research is warranted. I often tell my students that I address questions, not necessarily answer them, as a firm answer in nutrition would usually be preceded with the qualifier, it depends. An important point before we get started. This course is to provide information and to share about the science and scope of nutrition. It's not intended to give individualized advice. Although I'll share dietary recommendations from a variety of credible sources and health organizations, these are written with populations in mind, not necessarily specific individuals. It's important that you discuss any significant dietary or health behavior change with your healthcare provider. And if you have health or medical conditions for which diet plays a role in managing, it's advisable to consult with a registered dietitian nutritionist in your area. Tweaks and improvements don't necessarily translate to an overhaul in how you eat. I was recently struck by the philosophy of a former White House chef who wasn't a fan of telling people to eat right, rather to eat better. I applaud and echo that sentiment. Eating better can mean just some small changes or substitutions or additions in how we eat and a few of the dozens of food choices we make each day that can add up over time to improve dietary quality and overall health. Now, I found my way into the field of nutrition as a result of a high school English assignment. We were told to design and conduct a survey within the student body and to then write up the implications of that survey. At a loss as what to investigate, I chose what students ate for lunch. At the time, our school, now this was in the 70s, didn't have a true cafeteria. Rather, students brought their lunch or they bought meals from vending machines that offered sandwiches and soups, along with sweet and salty snack-type foods. Students that brought their lunches often also bought a snack or two from the vending machines. I found in my survey that the two most commonly purchased foods were Cheetos and Milky Way bars. In writing up the implications of my survey, I realized that wasn't so great as daily choices. I'd never considered vitamins or minerals or that we needed a certain amount each day for health, growth, and well-being. I looked at my mom's dinner selections of a protein like chicken or a pork chop, a starch like potatoes or rice, a vegetable side, a roll, and the classic 70s fruit cocktail in a new light. Variety, several groups of food. Ah, there must be some rationale behind this. So a couple years later, while I was browsing the college catalog, thinking I had to pick a major, I saw a course on vitamins and another on meal management. And the rest is history, at least my personal history. In the U.S., to become a registered dietitian nutritionist, or RDN, which was formerly just called RD, or registered dietitian, one must complete an undergraduate degree from a university with an accredited program in foods, nutrition, or dietetics, and then apply for and complete a dietetic internship before taking a registration exam. Many registered dietitian nutritionists like myself also hold advanced graduate degrees.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.